Okay, welcome back. Now to announce Glenn. He is an independent software engineer, and he will give you our next lecture. So once again, a small reminder, please use Whova for the Q&A, and Glenn and other speakers will make sure to follow up if they don't make the Q&A session during their talk. Of course, if you have any questions and if there is enough time, you can raise your hand and we'll give you a mic to do a live Q&A session. Glenn, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Welcome to my talk about TypeScript for better React components. First of all, hey, Belgrade, it's my first time here actually, even though I have like a lot of friends from Vienna. So I come from Vienna, Austria. I won't stay for too long, which is kind of like a bummer, but short story time. I arrived yesterday in the evening, actually late at night, which was super fun, but it ended up like with a bit bad story. So I tried to get my transfer, which didn't attend, and turned out I was arriving at the wrong date, which is kind of like a problem we have in JavaScript as well. So the thing is, the driver was saying he's coming. You mentioned that you're coming on November 2nd, but yesterday was November 1st. And that was the first problem. But somehow the organizers were able to figure it out. So that was good. I was able to get to the hotel. But then the hotel, the reservation was kind of messed up again. And they were like, this is the wrong date you're coming. You're one day too early. And then they basically said there is like no room left. So there is like, I was basically stuck yesterday night. And you know, it's kind of like the same what you have in JavaScript. You mess up with the dates. Luckily there was actually some solution. So I actually got to hang out with super nice guys, which are here the organizers for Heapcon. So I'd like to take this opportunity to give them a big round of applause for this amazing conference also. And really nice guys. That's how you run conferences, right? So a little bit about me. My name is Glenn Reyes. I'm an independent software engineer, tech speaker, and workshop instructor based in Vienna, Austria. You can reach me at Glenn Reyes, but without the vocals, without the E's on any social medias, like Twitter or X or whenever you want to call it, LinkedIn, Instagram, so wherever. And I'm also on glennreyes.com. You can see a lot of contents from me. And yeah. So I'm here to talk about React, but more specifically, we're gonna dive deep into talking about the typings in React. But before that, I want to start with a little history of typing in React. So so personally, when I first got into React, I think it was like around 2014 when I first learned about React, and by the time React was about 1 year old. So I think when I started, it was like version 12 or something, where you had to write create class, I think JSX was just introduced around that time. And cool thing about this is, from the beginning, React was already provided with some kind of typings called prop types. So basically, you were able to type your props on runtime by using prop types, which was really nice. Yeah, by the time React was around 2 years old when it was firstly introduced in the open source, it was firstly used 2011 at Facebook. And around the time when I learned about React, actually Facebook open sourced their own static type checker called Flow, which was nice, but I learned about it like maybe 1 or 2 years after. Which got me first into static type checking, so I didn't know actually that something like this existed before. And when it was around 2016, actually there was TypeScript around, and when React was introduced, there were communities that were already writing types for React, because of course by the time React TypeScript wasn't hadn't provided any. Types for React, so the community has to catch up and, you know, build some typings around that. And then around that, there was like other solutions like that I got or that I heard about, like Elm and Reason, you know, OCaml based, that basically compiled to JavaScript. And there was like a lot going on around. But I think where I firstly really adopted TypeScript was probably around 2018, 2019. And also, that's where the majority, I think, of libraries and frameworks started to adopt TypeScript more and more. And nowadays, you see pretty much like a wide adoption of TypeScript all over. So new projects, you barely see that they're typed without any typings. But what about from today in the future? I don't know. Maybe something else takes over, or TypeScript will completely take over, and there will be no JavaScript at all. Or you know, maybe we treat JavaScript as like a really low level language. We don't really know. Or maybe AI will just, you know, take over, and then we just are not developers anymore. We don't really know. So let's talk about, you know, from the beginning. TypeScript has been tightly integrated with other frameworks like Angular and Vue. So early on in today, TypeScript had like a strong and early association with TypeScript. So had also Vue 3, which was around since 2020, which was completely written in TypeScript. So TypeScript has been tightly integrated with both of these frameworks, libraries, but not with React, right? So today, TypeScript is not tightly integrated with React. The way you want to type React is actually like very unopinionated, and you can write it both with prop types and a TypeScript, and you can like even put flow on top of it. And we've seen like a lot of starters like create React app, create it in JavaScript, and then afterwards adopted TypeScript. Now Next.js like completely rewritten in TypeScript, and Remix, you know, built from the beginning up with TypeScript. And if you look into the React code base, you see you know, there is like no TypeScript at all in this code base. So you see probably the majority of files statically type checked with flow, but you know, it's pretty much JavaScript at all. So TypeScript types for React are purely driven by the community. And when React was published in the open, it didn't take long until the TypeScript community added, you know, community types to React, which is a great thing that it's not driven by a company or by an entity. So I personally think like that it's not too tight to TypeScript is a good thing, and it's universal to any TypeScript solutions that we might have in the future. Now let's talk about the actual topic of my talk, which are TypeScript patterns. So I want to start first with Boolean props. So every one of us knows that the React developers here in the room knows that like Boolean props are supposed to be for states, but not for any amount of states, but for exactly two states, like the disabled and enabled, or checked, unchecked, things like that. Whereas if you use it for a variant where you have like multiple states, for example, like primary, and then you have secondary, you quickly notice if you try to use it like this, it will become odd, and for a good reason. But actually, with TypeScript, it's actually possible to use it that way by writing discriminating union types. So what it basically does is, you know, you put a union between these two different Boolean props. And then once you type it, you basically get your TypeScript. Your TypeScript is about to yell about the problem, which makes it working again. A more common way, of course, is to just use the regular union type prop with string literals. So basically, that allows you to like have a selection of string literals, which is a lot less code compared to discriminated union types. I think, and probably the very obvious thing is that if you compare these two in your editor, you quickly notice that actually, if you put, pull up auto suggestions in your editor, you quickly notice that actually, if you just use just string literals, it is, you know, it is less cluttered than if you would just try to auto suggest with all your props. Now, how about enums compared? How do these come into place? So yeah, enums are really nice. It's a great option also to have multiple states. But there are some notable differences that come with enums. So for example, if you have something that have like the same value, the values with enums can be or the types can be distinct. So for example, if you have like red value as a value that are that are declared in two different enums, they are actually different. They're not the same because they're distinct. But the problem is with enums is that the more you add enums to your code, the more code you will have, and the more also import statements you have, like you see here. But on top of that, if you add enums, you probably won't notice, but it adds quite a bit of runtime overhead. So for a simple enum like this, it actually creates like a lot of code in your compiled JavaScript code, which can be not ideal. Which compared to just like regular string literals, you just have like a single line of code after all. So definitely, consider what to use and what makes sense where. Now, we have talked about Boolean props, unions and enums, which are great for passing component states. But what about, sometimes you might see something like this, like what about custom components? When do custom components come in handy? Should you create a primary button component over a primary button that has like a prop that has a primary or variant primary or something like that? When would you decide? So for me, I like to use custom components that are considered to be more actionable components. So what do I mean by that? So basically, I like that to be I think of custom components more of components that have some sort of logic implemented, built into the component that are part of some other component in composition. So for example, if you have like your submit button, part of your form component that actually already provides or can provide with some sort of loading state or disabled state internally. For example, if you submit your form, that it automatically provides like a default loading state you can still override. I think that's a great option for choosing like a custom component where you don't consider changes in the appearance or something like that. Now let's talk about enhancing components with HTML attribute types. In React, there is a variety of ways on doing that. You may have probably seen or used some of that, and you may not know all the differences, which is kind of like a bit tricky if you first get into like typing or enhancing your components with HTML element attributes. It's not super clear, so it can be super daunting. And I basically explain you what they all do now. So first of all, there is HTML attributes, which basically does not include like every type. So it's more of like a type that has like, you know, that can be used or that is compatible with pretty much every HTML element that you will ever use. So it's more of like what types do all of the elements have in common. So it provides like a different purpose on basically using that, but it's not the right one that you want to use to have like the complete set of elements available for you. And then there is HTML props, which basically uses all HTML attributes, which provides pretty much all types, but some of the types are too inaccurate. So for example, if you have HTML button element, the button types, type prop, not as button submit reset in a union, but instead like as a string. So it's more global, and it's not strict enough, which is nice because it's still also compatible, but it may not for certain purposes to be like very very accurate enough. And then there is intrinsic elements, jsx.intrinsic elements, which works, but in some cases also doesn't. So for example, if you try to extend it something with it, it returns you like pretty much accurate types, but it errors. The way probably you might have get around it with it, it's with the utility type by wrapping it with non-nullable TypeScript type, and then you basically get pretty much accurate types. But why not instead using button HTML attributes as a type, which basically is the same like what we have seen before, but without any wrappings or things like that, which is also good. But there is like an even better solution: component props. So probably what you are looking for is component props, and then pass as a string literal the element as a button. And this one basically provides you the types that you actually need. And there is three different versions of them that you may have seen or may have bumped. So if you are not very specific about whether the component or whether you want to have types that is specific to the to having a ref or not, then use just component props. Otherwise, if you want a ref, then use the one with ref, and otherwise just the one without ref. So these are the three to use, I think, and these are the ones that I think is very, very was for me personally the best to work with. Now let's talk about the React.FunctionComponent type. So React.FunctionComponent type has been around since the beginning, but it has changed over the time. So I think since React 18, they've changed it to look like this, and before that, they basically implicitly wanted you to add a children pop, which was kind of a different purpose for the function type. But now it's more like having optional like display name or prop types, which is super handy if you want to provide a display name to your component. It's good for dev tools, things like that, or for if you build a library provides some name on your component, or if you have an anonymous function that you want to provide then with some sort of name, so having it displayed in the dev tools. Now, how about reusing types and interfaces? I think reusing that is a great way to avoid like duplications of like many things. And it's also less maintenance and overhead. And I personally like to export only types and interfaces when you actually really want to import it somewhere else. So I think using utility types or writing simple types, it's often the question, right? So in this case, I have an example of using set is open, like providing a simple function type versus importing like a very complicated type from React. Now, when to choose what? So I think the question here is more about do you want it to have it more readable and understandable for like regular developers, or do you want to have like very accurate typings that is basically just the same, right? Now, personally, I think it depends, and I like actually accuracy, but maybe, I'd keep utility types until coworkers start to complain how unreadable the code gets, and then maybe move from this utility types into just simple types. But it really depends on the team, on what, makes you more productive overall, and how clean it is. Generally, I like to prefer reusability and keep like simplicity on a case-by-case basis. So there is like really for this kind of case, like no one fits for all solution. But I generally like to just be accurate, and then if people get confused, maybe move it to a simple typing. Now let's talk about comparing compound and polymorphic components. But first of all, what are both of these? So to explain a little bit, compound components are components where the customization is managed by the past component itself, whereas you have polymorphic components where the customization is managed by its primitive. So you basically, on polymorphic components, you have more a general control whether, you know, to customize this specific component, whereas, you know, compared to compound, you have, you know, you put the props of the actual component instead of the wrapper most of the time. I think a great example of compound components merging props together is the slots component by Radix with the S-child prop, which is kind of interesting. So basically what it does is you have here the tooltip.trigger component, and it uses, it just displays one element and exactly actually that one, the one from the children, but merges prop together. Which is kind of neat for like having like a polymorphic component kind of like this. And so, yeah, here displaying you a simple mock implementation of this. And basically what it does is you have inside a, you return react.clone element and then basically return the child component with the props merged together with its parent when you know it's, when it's a valid React component, and yeah, otherwise just return nothing, or return just the children if there is nothing. And then for usage or for the component that you wanna support that should support that, you basically check whether the S child component is set, and then render the slot component and then pass the props. And otherwise, you know, just use the regular or your default component, like in this case, the button for a simple button component. So polymorphics, on the other hand, are a great way, you know, as I mentioned, to just generalize customizations of elements or components. And the implementation of that is actually not trivial in terms of making it fully type safe and making it fully, you know, being very confident with your typings. So here's an example of a strict typed polymorphic component. And I think it all boils down into essentially this piece of code where you have, where you basically are calling react.create element. But in this case, I'm just, you know, using the Pascal capitalized variable and then render it as a JSX like this to attach it with the props. And then you can also write components with, you know, passing generics over that. So when do they come useful? It's nice because it basically allows you to pass generic types directly to your JSX components, like what you see here in the form provider. I think they are really great if you have like hooks or something inside of your component render that needs more detail about what kind of values or what kind of data you need to pass for your hook. So I've had this a lot of times with like forms where I wanted to provide like more granular detail about what data is actually passed into the form into the hook form that can then, you know, we're then able to work with more detailed you know, typings inside of your components. Now, react.forwardref. Typing react.forwardref components with react.forwardref wrapped is, I think, pretty straightforward. So you basically have a generic which takes the element and then some props. And then basically you're good to go and everything is like fully typed. But the problem is when you try to use forward ref with a component that has also generics or the props has generics, which can be kind of tough. And there is like multiple ways on how you do that. And of course you can typecast, and of course you can, you know, put type assertions or just any, and then it works like with everything, right? But my favorite way on how to handle this is by using this kind of thing, which is called augmenting forward refs. So you basically have this part over there before your component, where you declare some extra typing. So basically, TypeScript has some feature which is called higher order function type inference that allows you to propagate free type parameters on the auto function. I think that's what's happening here. And then once you have that in place, the only thing that you have to do is instead of having this generics, you basically type your component as is with the second parameter ref that is typed like this as well, so forwarded ref, and then you put your element there inside, and then you're good to go. And I think this article is brilliant if you want to learn more about this. And it has all the different options in detail that I've just mentioned before. So definitely check this out. I'll also add a link at the end of my slides for this presentation. Now, how about React context? So there is two types of context, ones that have values and ones that doesn't have values in the beginning. So in this case, I'll show you how to type it with values. You have, first of all, you have your context typings, which in this case is just the theming, so it's like light or dark. And then you pass the string literal to your create context as a default value, and then it works. And then you do the same in your component where you call or where you put, where you render the provider. So you have your state, so it may be, light or dark. So in this case, again, with a default of light. And then you have your provider component and pass it as a value. And then you're good to go. And then for consuming, you basically just use context and then pass it with your context. And then you have it fully typed like this, right? So without default values, what you have to do here or what you have to consider here is basically making it with a union of null and then pass it with null. And then you have it correctly typed with whether, because it can always like have no value in the beginning, even if you just set it right in the beginning. The way to check it is basically, or the way on of many of my components I check it is you put a statement into your custom hook. To check it whether it has or not, or error if it doesn't have it, and now overload function components. I think it's a great way, similarly to discriminative unions, for using props that are related in conjunction. So, for example, if you have data display as currency, or like the data display component that is provided in different kind of ways. So, for example, as currency, as unit, as plane. If you overload them, basically, every time you use type, because type is the one that is the one that has every type of that, it provides you or it enables you then the other props and types once you use it, which is I think really neat for leveraging this a bit more. Now there is always the question: should you use type or interface? And generally, types are more concise and easier to read, and overriding is possible via intersection typing, just like that. But it can't add like additional members, like what you do in interfaces. So basically, interfaces can extend other interfaces, which makes it safer than intersection types, and also which makes it great for enhancing third party. Libraries, which makes it a lot more type safe. But on the other hand, with interfaces, it's not possible to override it, which is kind of like good or bad depending on how you see it in context. In my personal experience, we had the case in one project where I hit the save button and it took like 5 seconds until actually the file was saved, and we couldn't figure out why. So what we did is we basically refactored all the typings that we had with typed with type to interfaces where possible, and then basically the problem went away. So there is a couple of instances where projects where this can happen, And what I found out is basically it reduced computational work by just using interfaces. So therefore, my take is that you should prefer interfaces for faster TypeScript compilation in your editor where possible. And if not, just use type. There is a lot of cases, especially if you have like dynamic types that you pass from generic and you know make a union out of it. Then of course I use type as well. So I'm not saying that you know type is that you shouldn't avoid at all, but basically prefer interfaces over type where possible to get faster types compilation as well. And on that note, I also encourage actually to use type annotations and especially in your function return types. And I'm just not saying that because you know it's my opinion or something, but I actually it's actually on the official TypeScript repository on GitHub on their Wikipedia site where they say actually that it reduces work for your compiler, and all the details and the performances are actually documented over there. Now, something that I also want to mention is here is. Because it's probably not very obvious, but it's you know it's kind of like underrated, but it can help you or mate to make it to be more productive. It's basically encouraging commenting actually types for your code. So here is a specific example why I find it particularly useful is I'm using Day.js. I really enjoy using Day.js just because if I start using the format function. I always forget what the shortcuts are or shorthands are for displaying specific formatting presets. And the cool thing is I just type it like this in the code base or in the editor, and then I can look it up right here, the docs button. So they documented the link inside of their comments, so they can just click and write them in the editor on this link, and then it sends me basically to the web page where it shows me all the different shortcuts, which is super handy. And this is, you know, I cannot do a TypeScript talk without talking about any. So I think everyone has probably kind of used that or heard about that. It's basically everyone's brate, but it's, you know, at the same time not, because you shouldn't use it. But if you use it, you feel like, yeah, there is gone, but you know. Of course, there is cases where you just have it, you just have any, because out of the nature, when you have your response from a fetch function, for example, it's just any, and you cannot just type assert it and then just assume that this is going to be the type. What you should be doing instead for these kind of cases is using runtime parsing. So I like to use Zod a lot, which helps me with that, which basically, you know, provide a schema, and based on the result, you know, it basically checks whether the type is there or not, and then you have it. Of course, I need to mention that type assertion or type casting and also non-null assertion should be totally avoided where possible. So what you can do for that is you can just, you know, these are examples, but you can use also, you can just use type guards or type checking functions to check whether something is there or not. You can see it here, very bottom, where you have type of query.data, check whether it's number or not, and then you know check whether to use it or not. There is a lot of tooling that I think can be really, really useful, and I'm pretty sure all of you or most of you already use them at some kind of at some point. That being said, great tooling should you know. Keep your code base clean without take advantage of tooling to keep your code base clean without any hassle. And there is just a few of them that I've just mentioning here, but definitely you know take some time for your tooling to have that in a good place and to make them you being more productive. The last thing I want to talk about is here about configuration. So I'm pretty sure everyone has you know this set in your TypeScript config, but there is tons of others that actually is not included in this strict flag. And I particularly want to mention this one here, which is non-unchecked index access. And I think it's so useful because if you try to index something, like typically if you infer some array, it just types you the type of an array. But if you try to index something, it's actually undefined, and this one makes it actually undefined, which is, I think, really cool. Now, one last thing before we wrap up. Remember that types aren't here to just have fun with errors because it's so unreadable. So TypeScript is here to give you like more confidence with your code. So the patterns that I've just showed you here are for helping you decrease the maintenance of your components that I've faced myself before. So yeah, definitely go spend sharpening your types, and hopefully you learned something about my talk. And with that being said, you can find all the information, all my slides, all some contents in this link. And also, if you want, you can also scan this QR code. My name is Glenn Reyes. Thank you very much.